My name is Max Maven, and I invite you to join me in a unique form of television. Together, we are going to attempt some, let's call them experiments, involving my mind and yours. The question before us is simple. Is it possible for me to influence your behavior working directly across this screen? Of course it's possible. Otherwise, I wouldn't be here.
Cut. Stop tape.
I will work from this television studio and attempt to connect with you in the privacy of home. Now, as I'm sure you can appreciate, this is no easy task. It's one thing to establish mind-to-mind contact when you're working in person, and quite another to do it working from here to there. Fortunately, I'm aided in this task by the unselfish and loyal participation of the Mavenettes. You can appreciate the tremendous amount of painstaking research that has gone into this project. To help cope with the overwhelming amount of information, I've had this computer installed right here in the studio.
Ouch.
Oh, I'm terribly sorry.
That's perfectly all right, Mr. Maven. Are you ready to begin our program?
Yes. It's been quite exhausting, and so far today's been rather weird, but I think when you put it all together...
How weird was it?
Never mind. It's time we got started. To begin, I think it best if we try some warm-up exercises. In this program, it will be important for you to follow my instructions. So we'll start with an experiment designed to test your ability to do just that. So if you would, listen carefully and do exactly as I say. Would you each extend your right hand? If you're confused, that's the one on this side. Good. Extend your right thumb. Extend your right forefinger. Excellent. Make a circle of the thumb and forefinger and touch it to your chin. No, that's your cheek. Well, now that we've established your ability to follow instructions, let's proceed. And for this next endeavor, stand up right where you are and we can begin. I said, stand up. That's better. Standing right where you are, hold your hands in front of you, and then clasp your hands together, interlacing the fingers tightly. Extend your forefingers, still clasping the hands tightly together, and then separate the forefingers approximately 2 inches apart. And what I'm going to do is to suggest to you that your fingers are moving back together again. It's as if I were reaching across the television screen and pushing your fingers together, closer and closer and closer, until they are once again back together, once again touching. Rather a touching experience, wouldn't you say? Well, I think we are properly warmed up and ready to begin our journey. And for this next experiment, come closer to me. No, right over here. Right up to your television set. Fine. Because together, we are going to try an experiment in international travel. And for this excursion into your imagination, I have selected 25 possible destinations. 25 locations around the world. You see a collection of flags representing countries from all over the globe. Look these over carefully, and then put your finger on any flag which contains the color blue. Are you sure that is the one you wish to start on? Or do you want to change your mind? Fine, we'll use that one. Move your finger left or right to the nearest flag which has some green. Now, move up or down to the nearest flag with some yellow. Finally, move left or down to the nearest flag with some green. I adore Italian cooking. How about you? As we move on to a more complex level...
Mi scusi, signore. Here is your check. I hope you enjoyed your meal.
We're doing a television special.
Signore, I have to close up.
As we move on to a more...
$19 and...
There was no Italian waiter in this sketch.
Che cosa
sketch? You have to leave. I'm in the middle of doing a television...
Come on, you pay $19.
I can't deal with this, okay?
Forget the 35 cents.
We'll let this one on the side. Forget it, okay?
Hey, where you go? Hey, you son of a gun. Hey, a big shot with your rings and you got...
As we move up to a more complex level of mind-to-mind interaction, you're going to need certain materials to continue our experiments. Now, these are simple objects you can find around the house. I'll tell you exactly what you need. First of all, some paper. This can be ordinary writing paper, or index cards will do just fine. Something to write with, a pencil or a pen. An envelope. A pack of playing cards. A die, a pair of scissors, and a length of string. 12 to 15 inches will be fine. You're also going to need some paper money, but I'll explain that when we get to it. I'm going to stop the show for 1 minute to allow you the time to get these materials assembled. I'll meet you right back here. I'm not kidding. You have 60 seconds, starting now. Have got your materials assembled, and we are ready to resume our endeavors. This next experiment is a bit more abstract in that it involves a host of variables determined by you.
So far, it seems to be going quite well, Mr. Maven.
Indeed it does. Why don't you help me introduce this next piece?
Certainly. Mr. Maven?
Yes?
I must say, I didn't think the bit with the Italian waiter was funny.
Apparently, you have not been programmed to appreciate comedy.
Oh, no, Mr. Maven. I have been programmed to appreciate comedy. That is precisely why I brought this up.
We'll talk about it later. In the meantime, just introduce the piece.
Is this one supposed to be funny?
Not particularly.
Oh, good.
For this next test, you will require three pieces of paper. On the first piece of paper, draw a large circle. On the next, draw a large triangle. On the last, draw a square.
I think I can handle this from here.
Are you sure?
Trust me. You will also require an envelope and three pieces of currency. You'll need a $1 bill, a $5 bill, and a large denomination bill. Now, for this last, a 10 or a 20 will be fine, but a 50 or a 100 is much better. Place the pieces of paper into a row in front of you. Put the circle to your left, the triangle to the center, and the square to your right. Now, distribute the bills, one inside of each design. The order of the bills is entirely up to you. Is that the order you wish to start with? Fine, we'll work with that. I'm going to switch some of the bills around for you, even though I don't know where they happen to be, so start by switching the $1 bill with the $5 bill. Good, now, switch what is in the circle with the one in the triangle. perfect. Now, switch the $5 bill with whatever happens to be to its right. If there's nothing to the right of the $5 bill, obviously don't make a switch. In the same fashion, if you would switch the large denomination bill with whatever is to its left. Perfect. Switch the $1 bill with whatever happens to be to its right. Good. Now, switch the bill in the triangle with the one in the square. And the one in the square with the one in the circle. Yes, at this point, you've made a mess of everything. I suppose I have no idea where any bill happens to be. I wouldn't know the location of the, for example, the large denomination bill. But take your envelope and pick up the bill inside the square. Seal it inside the envelope, and then send the envelope to Max Maven, Hollywood, California. Remember, the post office will not deliver mail without proper postage.
Mr. Maven.
Yes?
Marjorie Jejune, Intraglobal Survey Systems Incorporated.
Oh, the polling organization.
Yes,
yes, of course. Ladies and gentlemen, while you've been busy watching me, this woman has been busy watching you.
Oh, well, not me personally.
No, no, no. You see, Ms. Jejune represents an organization of several thousand field agents. And at this very moment, those agents are spread out all over the country, determining your reaction to this program. So, how are we doing?
Oh, so far, we seem to be a big hit. I like your hair.
Thank you.
It must be difficult to keep it properly groomed.
Well, actually, tell me about the survey results.
Oh, yes, of course. Follow me. The typical reaction nationwide seems to be quite enthusiastic. However, Mr. Maven, I would be less than honest if I didn't bring up the negative side.
Negative side?
Do you do it yourself, or does someone else take care of it?
Take care of what?
Your hair.
Ms. Jejune, you just referred to a negative public reaction. Would you kindly elaborate?
Oh, yes, of course. It seems that 17% of the audience did not understand the ending to your last routine.
You mean with the money?
Yes.
Well, I thought I'd made it quite clear that I was able to locate the large denomination bill from among the others.
Perhaps you are a bit too subtle for certain parts of the country.
Such as? Oh, well, no wonder.
Oh, yes, there's one more thing.
Yes.
According to our calculations, 32% of the viewing audience did not think the bit with the Italian waiter was very funny.
Keep up the good work, Mrs. Jejune. I'll be back with you. We've come to the musical portion of our program. But wait. Let's get you involved. I'll let you pick the music. To do this, we'll make further use of those three pieces of paper from our last experiment. So take your pencil, and on the paper with the circle, print the number 1. Now, on the triangle, put the number 2. And in the square, write down the number 3. Now we'll deal with the flip sides of your pieces of paper. On the back of the circle, print the number 4. And on the reverse side of the triangle, put down the number 5. And on the reverse of the square, print the number 6. Place your papers on the table in front of you, 4, 5, 6 side up. But mix them around so that I don't know the order of those three numbers. Good. Now, take the center paper and turn it over. At this point, you are looking at three different numbers, but I have no idea as to which three they are. I want you to add those numbers together. And in so doing, you've come up with a number from 1 to 15. And we're going to use that number to pick a song.
Please observe this list of 15 musical selections and remember the one that falls at your number.
Did you choose a song? Good. So did I. Enough. Go take a shower. And now for something a bit more intimate.
Mr. Maven?
Yes?
The dance number was wonderful.
Thank you so much. And now for something a bit more intimate. What we're going
to... Mr. Maven?
What is it now?
You can't follow a big production number with an intimate piece.
Why not?
It doesn't sustain viewer interest.
Fine. Now for something a bit more intimate.
You're losing them. Pacing is everything.
Well, what would you suggest?
Open it up. Try something on a larger scale.
All right. Let's go.
It's a world of its own. There's so much to do. We've got the joy that dreams are made of. Vegas is waiting for you. No one does it better. No one does it better.
And here we are at the fabulous Tropicana Hotel and Casino, a stimulating environment where we can try...
Mr. Maven?
Yes?
Steven Rogers, accounting department. Mr. Maven, I'm sorry, but you cannot shoot this scene here in this casino.
Why not?
Well, there's no room in the budget.
Silly, I've got the budget right here. It's all spelled out.
Oh, Mr. Maven, apparently you have not seen the revised budget. Ah. You spent too much money on the musical number. Too many dancers.
There are only two of them. Video overdubs. It was a technical stunt.
Mr. Maven, if you persist on shooting this scene here, we're going to have to cut the jungle number.
I can't lose the jungle number. It's integral to the show as a whole.
Well, then I suggest you shoot the next scene in Los Angeles.
Okay, okay.
All right, this way. Have fun.
Cocktails. Care for a game of chance? For this next experiment, you'll need a deck of playing cards. Shuffle the cards thoroughly. You can shuffle them in any manner you like. Try not to drop them on the floor because that does slow things down. We're going to use these cards to play a curious version of poker. Now, as most of you know, the game of poker is ordinarily one of luck. However, in this case, as I think you'll soon discover, luck has very little to do with it. Once you've finished shuffling your cards, hold the deck face down, and then deal out two face-down hands of poker. In other words, two piles of five cards each. One on your left and one on your right. The rest of the deck is placed aside. Take a look at the top card of the pile on your left. Please remember that card, because we're going to need to know what it is later on. Once you've committed the card to memory, replace it on top of the left-hand pile. Now pick up the pile on your right. And here I'm going to give you an option, because you're going to deal some cards from this pile away to the deck that you placed aside. But I leave it to you to determine whether you deal away one, two, three, or four cards. The choice is yours, and you don't have to tell me how many you're dealing away. That's your secret. The remaining cards in your hand are replaced onto the left-hand pile on the table. This buries your card somewhere in the middle of the combined pile. And remember, I don't know how many cards are now in that combined pile. Pick up the pile and turn it face up. Now I'm going to have you mix the cards in this pile, but this time I'll direct the mixing procedure. Follow carefully. Deal the top card to the table. Transfer the next card from the top to the bottom of the packet. Deal the next card to the table, the next card to the bottom, and so forth. Continue with the procedure until you run out of cards. Now you've mixed the pile, and I still don't know how many cards are there. Your card is lost. Take the combined pile and turn it face down on the table. Now, remove the top card of the pile and hold it face down in your hand. Say the name of the card you remembered out loud. No, the card you're holding is not the one you just named, so you can put it off to one side. Pick up the next card from the table pile. And again, call out the name of the card you remembered. No, that's not your card either. Place it aside. Take the next card from the table pile. And again, call out the name of the card you remembered. What? Again? Yes, the card you are holding is the one you just named. Take a look. Well, Mrs. June, how was the general reaction to that experiment?
Oh, I think you've got him now, Mr. Maven. The response seems to be equally divided between your basic bewilderment and your high-level freakout.
Wonderful. Anything else?
Yes. How do you keep it so symmetrical?
Keep what so symmetrical?
Your hair.
You know, it's getting kind of stuffy in here. Why don't we go outside for some fresh air? We have been on a hunting expedition, and we've managed to capture a huge, ferocious, dangerous beast. Bring on the beast. Now, it's no fun hunting alone, so I'd like to invite you to participate in this expedition. Why don't you tell them what they'll need, and I'll help the Mavenettes.
For this test, you will require 5 pieces of paper. Index cards are best, but any paper will do. You will also need a pen or pencil.
All right. On your first piece of paper, write down the word lion. Place that piece of paper aside, writing side up. On the next piece of paper, print the word panther. That one goes on top of the first piece. On your third piece of paper, put the word jaguar. Now that's a tough one, so pay attention. Fine. Put that on top of the first two. On the fourth piece of paper, put down the word tiger. On top of the pile it goes. On the final piece of paper, write the word duck. That goes on top of all. Pick up the packet of 5 pieces. turn the entire packet writing side down. And now, if you would, cut the packet. In other words, just as if you were using playing cards, transfer as many or as few as you like from the top to the bottom of the group. Good. Deal the pieces of paper into a face-down row on the table, going from your left over to your right. Gentlemen, kindly hold it down. Thank you. Now, where was I? Oh, yes, of course. You have a row of five papers face down in front of you. And as you cut the packet before you dealt them out, I don't know the location of any one of those dangerous beasts. Take the paper over to the right end of the row, turn it over, and place it off to one side. Now, that is not the beast we're going after. But that exotic cat is going to lead us to our prey. I want you to spell the name of the cat you just placed aside by tapping your finger along the remaining row of four, tapping from left to right, one tap for each letter of the name. Now, if you go past the right end of the row, simply go back to the left and continue tapping. You've arrived at one of the remaining beasts. That is our target. Hold up that piece of paper so that I can read it. A little higher, please. Yes, that's the one. Open the crate.
Get back. Stand back. Back into the crate. Back, boy, back. Close the crate.
This is the very latest in television technology. Observe. I have brought you to this exotic locale in order that we may explore
the... Signore, signore, please, you pay, please. I have tickets to a Jerry Vale show today.
I love television. Come up to your TV set. Closer. We are going to explore the ancient, mysterious science of astrology. I want you to think of a number. Any number from 10 to 20. Place your finger on the first pink circle, spring, and say one. Move your finger to the next circle, summer, and say two. Move to autumn and say three. Go to winter on four. Now move into the first yellow circle, Aries, on five. Move to the right into Taurus for the count of six. Continue counting your way around the yellow circles until you arrive at your thought-of number. Now you're going to count to your number again, but this time you will count around in the opposite direction, counterclockwise. Start your count on the circle you just finished on. Starting with one, count up to your number. Now you've arrived at a random astrological sign. Quite obviously, it would be impossible for me to tell each and every one of you your individual signs. There are far too many of you. I can, however, tell you my birth sign, and I'm highly flattered that you chose it. Thank you. You know, some people just can't stay away from the gaming tables. And for those of you who feel that way, I've arranged another game using the playing cards. So take your deck of playing cards and shuffle the cards thoroughly. Now, cut the pack into three approximately equal piles. Choose one of the piles. Take the other two piles and put them off to one side. We won't be needing them. At this point, all that I know is that the pile in front of you has between 10 and 20 cards. But I'd like you to know exactly how many cards there are. So hit the pause button and count the cards in that pile. Fine. Now you have a random number. But I want that number to be completely random. So let's do it this way. You are thinking of a two-digit number. Add those two digits together. For example, if your number were 12, you would add 1 plus 2 to give a total of 3. Whatever your total, deal that many cards from the pile in your hands to the discard pile on the side. Good. Now we have a completely random situation. Hold that pile in your left hand. You're going to deal some cards from the pile in your hand onto the table, making two groups, one to your left, one to your right. However, I'm going to give you a choice here, because you can deal one card to the left and one card to the right, or two cards to the left and two cards to the right, or three and three, or four and four. The decision is yours. Having done that, you now have one pile to your left, one pile to your right, and something left in your hands. Take either of the two piles from the table and put it with the discards off to one side. Now pick up the remaining tabled pile and look at the bottom card of that pile. Remember that card. It's yours. Take that pile and place it on top of the cards in your left hand. At this point, I have no idea as to how many cards there are in the combined packet you're holding. You are thinking of a card, and I have no idea what it is or where it is. Nevertheless, I'm going to find it. Now, who's going to find your card? I said, who's going to find your card? That's right, Max Maven. So we'll use my name as the way of getting there. We're going to spell my name together. And with each letter of the spell, you will transfer one card from the top to the bottom of your packet. M-A-X. M-A-V-E-N. Now, what was the card you remembered a moment ago? Well, if you turn over the top card of the packet, I think you'll see. I've indeed found it. Ready for something else? All right. Let's try something involving that pack of playing cards again. Now, this time we won't use the entire deck, just four cards, one of each suit. So look through your pack and take out any spade. Now, any heart. Any club. And any diamond. I've been studying this remarkable device, and I'm quite impressed. There are tremendous possibilities with this type of new microcircuitry. You can imagine how expensive a unit like this must be. I think in... We'll carry on. You are now holding four cards, one of each suit. Take the spade and place it face up onto the table in front of you. On top of that, place the heart face up. On top of those, the club. And on top of all, the diamond. Pick up the four cards, holding them face up. Take the top card, the diamond, and turn it over on top of the others. Now, cut the packet. In other words, transfer as many or as few as you like from the top to the bottom. Good. take the top two cards together as one and turn them over on top of the packet. Once again, cut the cards anywhere you like. Now turn the entire packet over. Let's repeat the procedure. Take the top two cards together as one and turn them over on top of the others. Once again, cut the packet anywhere you like. Now, at this point, I'm going to give you an option. You can repeat the procedure again, which is to say, take the two cards together as one that are on top of the packet, turn them over on top of the others, and then cut the packet. Or you can do nothing at all. The choice is entirely up to you, and to give you the freedom of doing this, I won't watch. All done? Let's confuse the issue just a little bit more and make it more difficult for me. Take the top single card and turn it over on top of the others. Now, take the top two cards together as one and turn them over on top of the others. Take the top three cards together as one and turn them over on top of the other. Now, turn over the entire four-card packet. At this point, you've really mixed things up, and the location or condition of any one of those four cards is completely beyond my ken. Nevertheless, I think I've got this situation figured out. It could be that all of your cards are face down, or perhaps there's one face up, or two, or three, or all four. But I believe you will find I am correct when I say that only one of your cards is reversed. Spread out your packet. You'll see that I'm right. Now, most people would be satisfied with that result. But I know there are a few of you who are saying to yourselves, I wish he'd tell me the suit of that reversed card. All right, just for you.
Dr. Maven, you're wanted in surgery. Dr. Maven, you're wanted in surgery.
I heard you the first time.
For this next test, you will need four pieces of paper. Index cards are preferable, but any paper will do. You will also need a pen or pencil, a die, plus a pair of
scissors.
Take your pencil and draw a line down one of the index cards. On another card, draw a large X across the entire face of the card. On a third card, draw two parallel lines down the surface of the card. On the final card, draw a squiggly line.
Squiggly?
Squiggly. Hold all four cards face down and mix them thoroughly. Mr. Maven.
Dr. Maven.
Dr. Maven, the jungle number was most enjoyable.
Thanks.
But I don't understand what we're doing in an operating room.
Don't worry about it.
I mean, going to the moon at least made some sort of a logical connection with the experiment, even if it was an expensive setup for such a minor fit of humor.
Why don't you take it up with Mr. Rogers in accounting?
All right.
Take your shuffled set of four cards and hold them face down. Then take your scissors and sever the cards neatly in half. This, of course, will give you two groups of four half cards. Hold those groups face down and place either group on top of the other group, making a pile of eight half cards. Now I'm going to ask you to cut the cards, but this time without using the scissors. In other words, cut them just as if you were cutting a set of playing cards, transferring as many or as few as you like from the top to the bottom of the packet. Having done that, take the top card and deal it face down onto the table. Take the next card, deal it face down on top of the first. The third card goes on top of that, and the fourth card on top of that. The remaining four-card group goes onto the table next to the first pile, but you can put it to your left or your right That choice is up to you. Now, I'm going to lead you in a series of actions, but you have a great deal of leeway. Take the top card of either of the two piles and transfer it from the top to the bottom of that pile. That will be fine. Let's do it again. Take the top card of either pile and transfer it from the top to the bottom of that pile. Good. Turn over the top card of the right-hand pile. I'm gonna have to make a small adjustment here. Take the top card of the left-hand pile and transfer it to the bottom of that pile. Fine. Now turn over the top card of the left-hand pile. We have a perfect match with the right-hand pile. So far, so good.
Mr. Maven.
Dr. Maven.
Dr. Maven, I spoke with Mr. Rogers. He doesn't understand what you're doing in an operating room either.
Tell him it's cheaper than a Las Vegas casino.
Mr. Maven, you're a very strange man.
Thank you, and here I was beginning to think you didn't like me. Well, let's continue. We've made a perfect match. You have two face-up pieces, and they do match precisely, so take those two face-up pieces and set them off to one side. We won't need them anymore for this experiment. That leaves in front of you two face-down piles of three pieces each. Pick up either one of those two piles and place it on top of the other pile, thus giving you a six-piece pile. You with me so far? Pick up the six-piece pile and deal it out into a row face down on the table. Now, you may deal this row from your left to your right or from your right to your left. The choice is entirely yours. What? Die? No, the patient isn't going to die, but that is exactly what we need for the next phase of this experiment, a die. So take your die and roll it onto the table, thus arriving at a random number, and if you look at that number and don't like it, you can change your mind, whatever you decide. Fine, we'll use that one. Count to that position from the left end of the row. Count to the card in the position of the number you just rolled, and turn the card face up, leaving it in position in the row. Now take a look at the number on the bottom of the die. And whatever that number is, count to that position in the row again, starting from the left end of the row. Turn the card at that position face up. And once again, we've got a perfect match. That's two for two. Okay, I'm on a roll. Take those two face-up pieces, put them aside. We don't need them anymore. We have four pieces left. Obviously, my task is to try to match up those four pieces into the two pairs and do that accurately. So, if you would, take the card on the, on the right end of the row. Take the card on the right end of the row, turn it face up. Okay, so the one to match that would be in the position... Come on, I'm sweating. In the position, second from... No. In the position on the very left end of the row. Turn over the one on the left end of the row. Yes, it matches. That's a perfect match. Okay, which means the last two match also. In other words, this operation has been a complete success. Thanks, Doc. That was wonderful. So, how's the reaction now?
Well, Mr. Maven, that last number registered very well. I think you've got their undivided attention at this point.
Aren't you going to ask me about my hair?
Work to do.
I think our rapport has reached a point where we can try something really unusual. Something involving a host of variables.
Oh, sorry, I wasn't paying attention. I was still thinking about the hospital sketch. The finish was very good, Mr. Maven. For this next test, you will require a sheet of paper, a pencil, and a pair of scissors.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Take your piece of paper and fold it in half. Neatness counts. Now, fold it in half again. And in half one more time. Those of you who are students of mathematics will realize that you've now folded this paper into eight separate rectangles.
unfold your paper. And take your pen, because we are going to fill information inside of each of these spaces. Starting in the upper left-hand corner, place the letter A. Next to that, the letter B. Now, don't get ahead of me. To the right of that, the letter C. And after that, the letter D. Now we'll move down to the lower right-hand corner and put in the letter E. Next to that, the letter F, then the letter G, and finally, the letter H. Those of you who have been paying attention will realize that these are the first eight letters of the Western alphabet. And as it happens, there are over 40 different words and names that can be formed out of this set of letters. Now, take your paper again, and one more time, refold the paper down to a single unit. But this time, you don't have to fold the paper in the same way we did before. In other words, you might choose to make your first fold along the long axis. And from there, you might choose to accordion pleat the paper. Or perhaps you would care to fold the paper in on itself. Or maybe you'd like to make the first fold off-center, in this fashion, and then fold inward, or fold outward. The point is, there are several dozen different ways in which you can refold this paper down to a single unit. You will choose one, please. Fold your paper down to a single unit in any fashion you like. And then when you've done that, take your scissors. Oh, and kids, remember, I'm a professional. Be careful when you use these shears, all right? Trim off the four edges of the folded paper. You realize in doing this, you will wind up with eight separate rectangles of paper, each one bearing a different letter of the alphabet. Now, depending on the way that you folded your paper back to a single unit, that will determine which of these letters are now face up or face down. Sort your papers into those two groups, the face-up letters and the face-down letters. Now, the law of averages tells you that you will probably have four face up and four face down. In your particular case, you may have three and five or two and six, whatever. Sort them into the two groups and then choose either one of those groups. Study the letters in the group you've just chosen, because I want you to take those letters and try to form a word. Now, if at all possible, try to use all of the letters in your group to form that word. If you have bad luck and have a set of letters you can't make a word out of, throw them away and try the other set. Take your time in using all the letters to form a word. I'll wait. All done? Terrific. You now have a word in your mind. And I'm going to ask you to send that word to me. Don't say it out loud. Instead, hear it in your own mind. Say it to yourself. Again, again, again. Cage, cage, cage. A profound success. We began our program with some warm-up exercises, experiments in physical control. Let's return to that concept, but with a more sophisticated variation.
For this test, you will require a length of string at least 12 inches long and some sort of weight to tie onto the string. You may use a set of keys, a piece of jewelry, or the scissors which were used in previous tests.
Now, tie your object to the end of your length of string. For my own use, I will forego the string and use instead a length of chain. But then again, I've had more time to prepare. When your object is tied to the end of your cord, hold the object suspended in front of you, so that it hangs free. Focus your attention on the object and concentrate on the sound of my voice. And I will suggest to you that that object is starting to move. Focus your concentration. The object is starting to swing back and forth, back and forth, wider and wider and wider, back and forth. Use your mind to make the object swing like a pendulum, back and forth. And as I continue to suggest to you, you will notice that the nature of the swing begins to change. It opens out into a circular pattern, swinging around and around, wider and wider. And now the rotation becomes smaller. The circle closes in, smaller and smaller and smaller, until the pendulum is once again at rest. We have time for one last experiment, and this one is going to take a great deal of concentration on my part, for I intend to try to follow your every choice, every step of the way. And if I slip up anywhere along the line, it's all for naught. Consider this assortment of simple designs. Come here to your TV set. Look the designs over carefully. Place your finger onto any design. Now you will spell out the name of your chosen design, moving your finger from space to space for each letter of the spell. You can move left or right, up or down. You may not move diagonally. Spell out the name of your design. Now that you have finished spelling, I feel confident that you are not on the rectangle. So we will eliminate that space. Once a space has been eliminated, you may no longer move there, but you still have 8 spaces in which to play. Move your finger 5 times. I'm certain you are not on the circle. So we will eliminate that. Move 2 times. You came awfully close, but you are not now on the triangle. So we can safely do away with that space. Move 3 times. Yes, eliminate the arrow and the diamond. We're down to 4 spaces. Move 3 more times. A moment ago you were on the square, but not now. So we can do away with that one. Move once, and we'll get rid of the heart and the cross. A rather appropriate conclusion. For after all, you are the star of this program. Your participation is responsible for my success. And I want to thank you for getting involved. So until next time, always remember to think good thoughts. You never know who might be listening.